In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of their Holy Spirit be with all of you. In the waters of baptism, Patrick died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with the Lord eternal glory. On the other side here. We place this crucifix upon his casket as a reminder that he who shared in Christ's suffering also shares in his victory. All right. Holy water.
Please join in singing number 439, Be Not Afraid, number 439.
And let us pray. O God, to whom mercy and forgiveness belong, hear our prayers on behalf of your servant Patrick, whom you have called out of this world. And because he put his hope and trust in you, command that he be carried safely home to heaven and come to enjoy your eternal reward. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated now as we listen to the readings.
Thank you. A reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth. The former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw the holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared as a bride aboard for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, God's dwelling is with the human race. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will always be with them as their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and they shall be no more death or mourning, wailing or pain, for the old order has passed away." The one who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new. I am the Alpha and the Omega, and the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give a gift from the spring of all life-giving water. The victor will inherit these gifts, and I shall be his God, and he will be my son." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all. Will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus, who died, rather was raised, who also at the right hand, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or the sword? No, in all of these things, we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death or life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. From the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." And Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. I'd like to welcome all of you here today, this morning, for Patrick's funeral mass, and especially on behalf of everybody that's here, to you in these first rows. Please know our sincere prayers and assurance of support for you during these most difficult days as you've lay to bear a son and a brother and a father, a brother-in-law, dear friend. Whenever death comes, even when we know it's going to come, it's still hard when it gets here. There's such a finality to it, and it shakes us deeply, especially when the person who's died is still pretty young, still pretty much so in the prime of life. It makes it even more difficult to say goodbye. And yet it's important that we've gathered here in church, because here in this place, we listen to the Word of God, and if we do listen to the Word and allow it to penetrate our hearts, it may very much so change our perspective on suffering and on death. And so it's important for us to allow that Word of God to soak into our hearts like a gentle rain in the springtime that will eventually produce much fruit. And so as we heard in that beautiful first reading from the book of Revelation, Revelation is written to a suffering church who's being persecuted by the Roman Emperor,
The Christians are being thrown to the beasts in the Colosseum and burned alive at night as torches in the streets. And so the book of Revelation is written in kind of a code and symbolic language, in a kind of a literary genre called apocalyptic. And basically the hidden message for the Christians who heard it was, hang in there, don't give up. The bad guys are going to eventually get their comeuppance when God turns the tables. And so it's written to a suffering church. And all of you know what suffering is, right? That's why you're all crying. You got your tissues. And the message of that passage is to hold fast, stand firm, and not give up, but trust that ultimately on the other side of the mystery of suffering and death will lie God's tender care. It's the beautiful image of God wiping every tear from their eyes, and then he'll give them the gift of everlasting, refreshing water, right? So it's a beautiful image that offers us hope. So too we sang in that beautiful psalm response, to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. A good third of the psalms are called the psalms of lament, where people are crying out to God that their enemies are after them, their weeds are growing in their garden, you know, the harvest has been taken by the grasshoppers, and who do they turn to in their pain? They turn to God, and they say, very much so, a prayer that says, God, I'm miserable right now, but I know you listen, I know you care, and all but one of those psalms of lament ends on an upswing of hope. And so even though they're pouring out their hearts in sorrow and mourning to God, they always end on an upswing of like, but I trust that you're going to be with me and it's going to get better. And so it's a good psalm for us to pray today. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. To you, I lift my soul, broken as it is. In the beautiful reading from the Romans, Paul's letter to them, he talks about how nothing shall separate us from the love of God that comes to us in Christ Jesus, right? And so St. Paul was so grasped by Jesus' love that he suffered terribly, right? Paul took on himself the stonings, the whippings, the scourgings, being driven out of town. And Paul kept going back, right? Because he was convinced that God so loved him that he had to complete that mission that God had given him of preaching the good news. It's what we celebrate during these days of Easter, right? At Christmas time, we celebrate the fact that God so loved the world that he came into the world as the Lord Jesus in the flesh as a baby. And just a week and a half ago, we celebrated him carrying that cross the day after he gave us the gift of the Eucharist, that he was nailed to it, he died on it, he was put in a tomb, and then Sunday morning, that first day of the week, the women go to mourn, and he's gone, right? And not only is he gone, he's risen, and he plainly shows them himself to those who were closest to him, to the women, to the apostles, and he shows very much so that nothing can separate us from God's love, right? And so those are important readings for us to listen to and to take to heart, that God is for us. God is for the human being. God is for the sinner. God is for us to one day be with him in heaven. And that's the message of salvation that we celebrate for these 50 days of Easter. In the passage that I read from John's Gospel, Jesus is preparing his apostles for his departure. And he knows that he's going to have to go to Jerusalem. And like all prophets who were faithful to their mission, he knows he's going to die. And so he's trying to get them ready for that. And he tells them that he's going to prepare a place for them. And the apostles don't get it. Thomas, being bold, says, where are you going? We don't know how the way. And Jesus basically says, hey, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. If you want to get to the Father's house, you need to imitate and follow me. So I want you to think about how Patrick tried to live his life as one who followed the way and the truth and the life. The way is Jesus' humble way of loving others and meeting them where they're at. I know you said one of his greatest gifts was that he was a people person, loved to be with people. And in his role and job as a seller of real estate, he was always happy to meet especially first-time buyers and to try to find the perfect house for them, right? He would listen to their needs and try to match them up with a dwelling place that would help them to raise and live the kind of family life that they wanted. And so I know that even after you said he stepped down as a seller of real estate, he was always interested in making the experience of interacting with people more pleasant. As a father, you know, he was there cheerleading you on at your events and coaching you, and even as you became young adults, always there to support you on the long phone calls, always there to gather the family for a wonderful party. He loved to grill his meats that he himself had taken from the land, and loved his hunting and his fishing, loved the outdoors, and he loved when people gathered, right? And he wanted to make sure that nobody would be left behind or left alone, so he was always the last one to leave. So I think, you know, he's the one who really did try to live the way of loving others. The truth, what's the truth? The truth is that if we selfishly cling to our lives, Jesus says we're going to lose them. If we give our lives away in love, we will have fulfillment in this life. So we're imitating him. So the truth of the matter is we're only happiest when we are loving. We're only happy and fulfilled when we give ourselves away to others. So I want you to think about Patrick's generosity, how he was not afraid to roll up his sleeves, inconvenience himself for the good of somebody else, right? The gospel passage that you were thinking about reading, number 16, is the grain of wheat image. So Jesus says, unless the grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains just a grain of wheat. But if it falls and dies, it produces much fruit. So I got it in besides. But it's a beautiful image, especially for somebody who gave their life away in love. So the idea is the seed just can't kind of sit there on the ground and say, I'm going to be a seed. That's what I want. I want. No, what the seed does is eventually the moisture begins to swell it, and it pushes down a root, and it pushes up the first two leaves, and it surrenders. It's not a seed anymore, right? So too for us human beings. The Lord doesn't want us to be human beings forever. The Lord wants to clothe us with immortality. He wants us to become eternal saints with God forever in heaven. And the only way we do that is by surrendering that desire to be selfish and really become generative, loving others. And again, Jesus says he's the life. And so we, as much as wonderful as this earth is, no matter how big the biggest fish he caught or how big the biggest number of points he got, he should come sit on my couch upstairs. You can get some nice, well-fed ones out front at night. But Jesus says he's the life. And ultimately, as wonderful as this life is, we believe that God's got something much better for us, right, in heaven. And I want you to think about that. If we really do listen to the Word of God today and let it soak into our hearts, it can change us and give us hope that death is not the end, but a comma to a new part of living, right, with the Lord. I'd like to leave you with the image. I know you said he loved the water. He loved the ocean, loved Lake Erie. And even as we were all looking at the sun the other day, I want you to think about how you can be out on the water and there could be a boat moving away from you. And as it moves away, you know it gets smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until at some point you don't see it anymore, right? We know it's not gone. It doesn't fall off the edge. We know that the boat has passed beyond the horizon and we can no longer see it, but we know it's there. I want you to think about death in those terms, that as our loved ones fade because of suffering, because of impending death, they become smaller and smaller. But we know that on the other side of death, from the promised land of heaven, they first appear as a little blip on the horizon as they come into full view, especially of those who've all gone before us, our parents and our grandparents and those who've loved us. So today as we give thanks to God for Patrick's life. I want you to, if you didn't get to say goodbye, if you didn't get to whatever, talk to him now in your heart and know that he listens. And I want you to also give thanks to God for the ways that Patrick brought joy and laughter and the fulfillment of your life by his presence. And so, but again, think about that image of the horizon, right? His life is not over, it's changed. And we trust and hope that he's with the Lord and all those who've gone before us.
And let us now stand as we offer our prayers to our Heavenly Father.
For Patrick, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who bear the burden of cancer may never feel forsaken by God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends who cared for Patrick so that he was able to spend the rest of his life at home, surrounded by love, that they may have their spirit and strength renewed, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may call Patrick to happiness in the company of his father, Bill, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the continued good health and long life of his mother, Carolyn, grandmother to his three children and 11 nieces and nephews, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may deliver the soul of his servant Patrick from punishment and from the powers of darkness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may establish him in light and peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. O God, if it be your will, please grant these prayers because we ask them in the name of Jesus, who is Lord forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated now as the gifts of bread and wine are brought forward.
Please join in singing number 407, Be Thou My Vision, 407.
Please stand and pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look favorably on our offerings, O Lord, so that your departed servant Patrick may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels, archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy,
kneel or be seated. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Edward our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Patrick, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. And remember also our brothers and sisters who've fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who've died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face, and have mercy on us all, we pray, that with Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, St. Francis, St. Patrick, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us stand. And at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ, for the kingdom. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. And may the peace of the Lord Jesus be with you always. Let us offer to one another a sign of his peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to enter under my roof, but only say that my soul shall be healed.
Please join in singing number 535, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, number 535.
Yeah. this despairing life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light, and where there's sadness, ever joy. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled.
And let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that your servant Patrick, for whom we have celebrated this Paschal sacrament, may pass over to a dwelling place of light and peace through Christ our Lord.
Trusting in God, we've prayed together for Patrick, and now we come to the last farewell. Indeed, there is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see him again and enjoy his friendship. Although we may disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another with our faith in Jesus Christ. Songs of the angels welcome you and guide you along your way. May the smiles of the martyrs greet your own as darkness turns into day. Songs of the angels bring you home before the face of God. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Patrick, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who've died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings which bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. So merciful, Lord, turn toward us. Listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. In peace now, let us take our brother to his place of rest.
Please join in singing number 450, Amazing Grace, number 450.
Just give us a minute, okay? Five feet.